Well, good afternoon, everyone. Thanks so much for coming. I know it's finals week, but thanks a lot for taking your time away from exams a little bit. So I will talk today about the research our group has been doing on trauma resuscitation, as Michael just said, for the past 7 years. But more specifically, I will focus really on the design of a display we just recently developed for trauma teams to improve their teamwork, situation awareness, communication, and information sharing. But just before I begin, I would just like to know like the kinds of people sitting in the audience. So like just students, HCI, CSCW, if you can just show up hands, okay. Any medical experts? I know there are a few, okay. And anything else? Okay, well, excellent. Anyway, so I know Michael did a great introduction, but I just quickly wanted to just run through a few facts and background information about me. So I did information science, studied information science at Rutgers University, where I got my PhD. And I got interested in HCI at that time, working with some really great people like Marilyn Tremaine, mother of Kai. And I got interested in the medical domain as we were approached by medical experts from Robert Wood Johnson University Hospital in New Brunswick, New Jersey, asking us to help them with problems they're seeing in this medical environment. So I like to say that my mission is to build IT solutions that fully support the social environment and for which they're built. But in effect, actually, I'm really the bridge between the domain experts and the engineers and computer scientists and people actually who build, because I don't build myself, but I really like to be that bridge. So the research domain is really complex socio-technical systems, and of course within this, my focus has been on trauma resuscitation. And my research is really qualitative, mostly qualitative. So what I do, I really immerse myself in the environment. I study the teams, I become one of them, I wear white coat and badge if I get one. So it's really user-centered, participatory approach where I interview people, observe, do a lot of analysis of video artifacts if I get access to video or artifacts, and design workshops and focus groups. So it's very, very participatory, very qualitative, which is nice because it complements then all the quantitative stuff that doctors like and work on. So it's a sort of like a nice mixed method approach that comes out of the entire research. So our domain, our sites so far have been basically, mostly actually, the most studies we've done were at Children's National Medical Center in Washington, D.C., which is a pediatric trauma center. And then my research, dissertation research I did in New Jersey, New Brunswick, with adult trauma center. But since I moved to Philadelphia, I just realized that within 10 blocks, I have like 5 trauma centers, and it's really hard to get you know, to work with all of them. So I mostly focused with, still my focus is really for some reason on pediatric trauma. So I work closely with CHOP and also trying to get my foot into Hahnemann University Hospital, which is actually affiliated with Drexel. Okay, so the big question is why trauma, right? Why do we study trauma? Why is it such an important domain? And actually, it remains one of the leading causes of death and disability among children and young adults. And I'll just show you some facts. This is actually based on the most recent report for the North America. Data was submitted by 805 trauma centers, level 1, 2, 3 facilities. And in 2012, we had about 833K trauma admissions. And what's interesting that injuries really peak between ages 14 and 29, and they say that mostly it's because of these multi-terrain vehicle crashes that kids get into. And as you can see, there was like about 200K admissions just between this age group. But what's really nice to see is the overall mortality level, which would you say, right, it's relatively low, 4.15%, which means that it's almost 800,000 lives saved, right? And that tells us that this domain is really important, this early care of severely injured patients right after injury. It's really important to be efficient, error-free, and very fast and rapid, which is why we realized that it's really important to understand and study these teams and see if there's anything that technology can do to make their work even more efficient. So just a little bit of background for those. Has anybody, by the way, I know it's a hard question, but just God forbid, but anybody ever been in a trauma resuscitation bay? Not as a doctor. Okay. Good. So what is really trauma resuscitation? It's a fast-paced, dynamic medical domain. We have a team of doctors, nurses, technicians that work towards a couple of goals. First, they need to stabilize the patient, right? They just got a severely injured patient, gunshot wound, car crash. So it's a really, really critical injury. And they're trying to stabilize this patient, identify life-threatening injuries, and then develop a plan for patient hospitalization. Now, what's nice about this process, though, that it's not a free-form activity. So they have this so-called algorithm called Advanced Trauma Life Support, or ATLS. It's a protocol, well-defined protocol, that helps standardize the care process. And it consists of two phases, primary and secondary survey. The primary survey is just a quick, a couple of minutes, evaluation of basic physiological systems, like airway, breathing, circulation, disability, which is a neurological assessment. And then they go into this longer evaluation, which is secondary survey. So here they do head-to-toe evaluation just to identify any other injuries the patient might have sustained or they're not visible right off the bat. As far as teams goes, that's also interesting. So what we are having here are multidisciplinary teams. So you have surgeons, you have emergency medicine physicians, you have nurses, technicians. You have specialists, anesthesiologists, respiratory therapy, you have critical care, right? So a lot of different specialists depending on the injury. You also have hierarchy. So we have team leaders who are overseeing the whole process, delegating tasks. And then you have other people who are executing the tasks. So there is even role-specific positioning around the patient bed to allow for this division of labor and coordination of work. So for example, right here we have the leader who coordinates the care usually at the foot of the bed, just to have a nice environment, overview of the room and just patient and the care. Then you have person right next to the patient, a nurse right or technician, depending on different trauma centers have different labeling for these roles. But they're basically all this, right, doing the same thing. So this person, for example, sets up the equipment, connects the patient, right? So there's a very, very well-defined set of responsibilities. And then we also have, for example, scribe nurse, who is sitting, standing at the corner or again at the foot of the bed, really documenting everything that happens in the environment. So they have this huge flow sheet that writes down everything that happens. So the teams are nice and interesting to study. And I was just talking over lunch that this is really a nice environment, like a natural laboratory to study these collocated, ad hoc, interdisciplinary teams, just to understand how they function, how they interact, how they communicate, and then see, you know, what kind of opportunities there are for technological innovation. Okay, well, so what was interesting there is that most of the time and how these teams function is through verbal communication, information sharing. So there is surprisingly few technological tools there, right? Information technology that you can see in these environments. So this is, for example, what a typical trauma bay looks like. You see, we haven't gotten to a Stanford Medical Center trauma bay, but next time. I always like to take pictures of the trauma bays I visit. So this is and it's an interesting story. This was a picture taken early 2010. And this is the most famous, biggest trauma center in the nation, Shock Trauma Center, University of Maryland Medical Center in Baltimore. So they are the ones that just receive mostly regional cases, but that's where, for example, military trauma goes. So they're really the biggest and best known. Now, this was in early 2010, where they just started talking about this really good, a big overhaul, a new building, trauma bay of the future, envisioned by Pentagon. They invested some $160 million into building it. It was scheduled to open this year. So as you can see, super spacey, fancy looking, right? Very, very futuristic, very, very modern. And what struck me here also is this array of displays and information technology just to help people see what's going on with the patient and everything. And guess what, right? It opened, really. Future is here. This is the picture from of the new trauma bay at the same center. And right, it looks fairly like it was envisioned. You still have this modern equipment, tools, medical tools, but also an array of displays around showing different kinds of patient information. Yeah, much less present, and so I haven't actually, I only took this photo from their Picasa album. I haven't really been there since they opened it, and this picture was taken like November 7, so it's fairly recent, right? So they just opened it recently. Now, you know, what happens at our centers that, you know, don't have $160 million to do these kinds of investments? And actually, we see some progress. So this is the trauma bay of our hospital in DC. I keep saying our, but the Children's National Medical Center, where I do most of my studies. And 2 years ago, we, in collaboration with doctors, we decided to introduce these large wall monitors in the trauma bay to help augment the vital signs data, because the vital signs on this tiny monitor here, people have to turn around, it's really hard to see. So they decided to put these large wall monitors to augment the data, vital signs data. But the point I'm making here is that we are seeing increasingly these large wall monitors throughout the medical settings, ORs, hospital wards, like you name it, right? You're just seeing them everywhere. And they're really helping teams coordinate care, be aware of what's going on in patient rooms and different areas of the hospital. And one of the questions that I found interesting in exploring is that, okay, can we actually put it in here? But for what? These teams have been functioning like this forever, right? They save patients' lives, they do their work, they just get in there and get out in 16, 20 minutes, whatever it time takes to stabilize the patient. So if we introduce these displays, which would be super cool, what are we going to use them for, and how can they actually effectively be built and introduced to actually support the care? So that was really the question that sort of has been driving a lot of research and studies, and really understanding, right, the domain, understanding where the inefficiencies are and problems. So just to name a couple of things that we've looked at, work coordination, team errors, visual displays, attention, workload, information needs, leadership. So there was lots of studies looking at different aspects of the teamwork and how they function and what the domain and inefficiencies are. So one finding that really struck is that the key problem that we found is that there is actually a lack of mechanisms that help teams accrue all the information that's coming from different sources at different times. So you have different team members evaluating and doing patient work, and then reporting the findings to the team leader, who then needs to integrate this information, makes a decision, and decide on the next step, right? And these information sources and these information types come at different times, sometimes on the order of minutes. So it takes some time to really come back and remember and recall and ask again. And so there's a lot of redundant communication, a lot of errors happening and information missing and coming through. So rather, right, that making this teamwork efficient, this collective memory that's supposed to actually help people, teams function better, actually makes trauma teams a little bit less efficient than they should be. So, you know, we believe, sort of our group thinks that the way to go and the way that technology can best support these teams is really through these shared information displays and technology that helps this information integration, synthesis, really for fast, easy access for these people who are deciding on what needs to be done. Right, so externalize that memory, and we can either do it through shared displays, right, that can show that information for teams to access and decide, or we can also develop some interactive interfaces for less busy team members who are not hands-on as much as some people on the team to actually input information, interact, and do some interesting things. Yes?
Am I interpreting that correctly to say that the team leader no longer actually needs to interact with anyone else on the
team? No. I mean, yeah, it might look that way, but we don't want to prevent that, right? Communication is really extremely important in that kind of situation. So it's really just, so you would still hear probably a lot of communication going on, and it's just that it's more like a status update on what's going on, what's with the patient, what's with the team, where we are in the process, more than just really completely fixating on that display and forgetting others in the room. So that's the idea, right? That it really just helps the information flow, not really stops it, kind of. But that's a good point. See, I never really thought it. The graph really reflects that kind of idea, but it's a good point. Okay, so here we go. That's the information display. That's the latest design that we developed. This was, well, work over the past 3 years and maybe most intensely over the past year that we've been developing for these teams. So this is joint work done with collaborators at UCSD, at Rutgers, our trauma people, of course, at Children's. So my idea for today was really to tell you, describe you a little bit this entire design process behind this display, how we went about identifying information for this display, how we went about designing it and really figuring out where to put what, how to configure different kinds of information on it. And then also an important thing, and I think it came through the discussion with Joy at the one-on-one meetings, that how do you design, like in HCI, we are mostly designing for individuals, right, in human-computer interaction, kind of. But when we have these teams that are interdisciplinary, ad hoc, how do we really approach design for something that's so diverse and yet needs to be really fitting and good for everybody on that team, right? So I wanted to talk a little bit about those design tensions, right? How do we approach, how do we manage those design tensions? So that's really the idea for the rest of this talk. So here is just a quick snapshot of the entire iterative design process. It spread over 8 months. We started in November last year, finished in June this year, so it goes sort of like weird sausage way. But basically, it was six design and evaluation phases. Within each, we had a couple of different sessions. We started off with a set of design participatory design workshops that really provided foundation for the display. And then we tested in simulation, did iterations, did some heuristic evaluation, and again, simulation testing. These are high fidelity simulations, and I'll tell more about that. Followed up with another set of design workshops. And then finally, again, simulation settings. So this entire process really allowed us to explore different solutions, to go back and forth and see trial, error, right? See really what works, what doesn't, why things work, why not. Over the course of this process, we had 39 unique participants, and these were actual trauma resuscitation members, residents, fellows, anesthesiologists, respiratory therapists, so different people that participate regularly in the process. And we had 13 design iterations throughout the process, but I'll basically just show you the main ones that we tested and how it progressed, evolved. So, right, we started with this first set of participatory design workshops where we gathered entire teams. So we had representatives from each role on a team at each workshop. These were like a 2 hour long workshops. And the purpose of these workshops was really to understand clinicians' perceptions of what information really needs to be, what information matters to them, what really needs to be up there on that display. How do you want this information presented, right? Because we know there's lots of differences in their needs. How to make this information dynamic so that it really fits their needs and the context of the resuscitation. And then also, what is the purpose of the displays? We believe the purpose is to help the information flow and to really facilitate and help the team awareness. But do they think the same, right? Is that something that they perceive this display as well? So the workshops had an array of activities because we really wanted to get their engagement, their participation in helping us get some ideas on what to do with these displays. So we first asked them to recall the most recent resuscitation event they participated in, and just to help them ground their thinking about the designs, and then sketch their ideal information display. Right? How would you imagine this, like based on your role, what your role on team is, sketch this ideal information display, what would you like to see up on the wall? And these are just some of the sample sketches that we got from different roles, and you can see like sort of, you know, some commonalities, but then you also some differences in the way people presented information. Once they finished with these individual sketches, we asked them to come as a group and then do actually a group design of a shared display, combine their individual wants and wishes and features that they included in their individual designs. And this really helped them, you know, think more deeply about just what the display really is about and what information needs to have. So because we're dealing with these team hierarchies, we're dealing with different disciplines and backgrounds, it was really important to give everybody equal voice and participation. Because as we know, like surgeons sometimes can be really outspoken and take over entire conversation, whereas nurses feel like they're not, right? They don't have that power to really speak up or do something. So we really wanted to remove those boundaries and really allow everybody to voice their own concerns and tell us what they think and what they like about these things. So we gave them these stickers to rank information items that they thought were most important to them as a role. So we color-coded those stickers just to be able to trace back what role coded what. And we also gave them opportunity to voice their concerns. So we gave them these post-its and asked them about, just write any concerns you have about using this display in the room, right? And the, just some of the concerns that you, of course, would hear in this kind of environment. Is the systems going to be reliable? Is it going to be accurate information? Is it going to change dynamically with the patient changes, right? Because this is a very, very dynamic environment. Who's going to be putting the data in? How it's going to, you know, how are I going to get that data from the patient or environment up on the display? So those were some valid concerns that we, of course, keep exploring and thinking about. But what these workshops really allowed us to get is identify these critical pieces of information that people perceived as really important to be up on the display. So 8 categories of information emerged. On top, the most important was just the patient information. Who is the patient? What's the name? Weight? What was the mechanism of injury? How the patient got injured, right? Then the third overall important part was that algorithm, A, B, C, D, and simply just the findings from each of the steps throughout the evaluation, just to have the abnormal, normal findings and what the patient, what the status is. And then, of course, vital signs, medications, the times they were given, dosages, different tubes, lines, drains, or in translation, different procedures that were done to patient, IV fluids, administered blood, labs, and disposition plan. So these were the nine categories, that emerged from the process. And that's a lot of information, right, to include on a, well, tiny, but display, right? So I'll talk about how we dealt with some of these things. And then another thing, so we already knew that we have these differing information needs, but really, really this process allowed us to tease out these role-based differences in the team. And here I just really highlighted 3 roles and how they presented or how they wanted radiology and lab studies to be shown on the display. So we have anesthesia who only wants labs that were ordered and the results. Then you have scribe who wants both labs and radiology ordered and results. And then you have respiratory who just wants lab results, right? So we have these different ideas of how information should be presented and who needs what, but then how do you really reconcile that for a shared common display? Okay, so here we go. This was our very initial design. This was the version 1. We tried our best, right? We really put everything we thought we could from that list of nine categories, and we thought that we could somehow, make it really fit all these different representations that people had about, right? So this version had the vital signs and trends. It also had all the abnormal and normal findings from the ABCD steps and even a little picture of the patient in the corner. So it was a lot of stuff, a very sort of cluttered, low visibility design. The plus was really that there were vitals involved. And we just felt that as a team and some of our collaborators on the team, so this wasn't shown to the actual trauma teams and people, this was just within our team, we just felt we really need to pare down and really need to make this more readable and visible and manageable. So this is the version two that actually was tested in a simulation setting. And we still kept the ABCD steps, normal, abnormal findings, but we sort of separated information into different chunks, pared down a little bit of, on the amount. We dropped the vital signs for a couple of reasons. First of all, there's already vital signs monitor in the room that people can use. So we thought we are dealing with the limited screen estate, so why cram it with everything when we can nicely be distributed across the room? But we also had a technical difficulty. How are we gonna feed vitals from the vital signs into our display? And with biomedical department, biomedical engineering department at the hospital, we are considering a couple of choices of how to deal with that. But it's a challenge, right? And also like a lot of medical legal issues, and now you're transferring patient data from the monitor. So it's a lot of issues. Anyway, so this was the display that we call activity-based design because it really follows the order of activities that teams perform and shows the status for each activity, right? And it also shows the patient status information. So we went into simulation setting and did two scenarios with this display to teams, to different teams. And after each simulation scenario, we gave this paper prototype of the display and asked team members to put like and dislike stickers on each of the pieces of the information they liked or found useful or didn't like. And then we had a big group discussion just about the display. So this was the layout, right? So this was the real trauma coat room in the hospital. That's what I'm saying. We're really using it as a natural laboratory to really study lots of different things. But so we did it in a real trauma room. We had these two information displays mirrored so that everybody in the room can have a view of the information. And this is the usual setup. So, right, we had two teams and their configuration, composition, and positioning was as usual in the real world scenarios. So what did we find from this first set of simulation? So, right, so it was cleaner design. People liked that. We showed completed procedures and patient information. But the biggest concern with this activity-based design is that people felt it wasn't dynamic. It didn't look like it would change with the patient status changes, right? So you show, yes, the airway's patent, but is it ever gonna change if suddenly patient's airway deteriorates? So it was still too much information, felt too static, and even though they really appreciated and wanted this patient information status, they still felt that going, linearly showing A, B, C, D is not really the most intuitive way of presenting this information. So we were like, okay, probably, yeah, we need some more. We need to go back to the drawing board. We need to rethink how we're gonna present this. What we figured is that can we actually bring it up to the team level, and rather than just showing the abnormal and normal findings, actually show how is team doing and how is team progressing throughout the process. And we realized that we could actually draw data from the leader's checklist, which was implemented recently in the trauma bay there. We changed the design. This was the sort of turning point in the design where we drew the data from the checklist, and now we remove the patient's the abnormal and normal findings because it's already something that they can see as they are looking at the patient. But they don't know where they stand in the process, right? How are they doing as a team? How are they progressing? So we are still keeping the procedures that were completed and that were done, but we are showing them on how good they are throughout the process. So it was a very checklist-like, checklist-driven design. So it's activity-based design, but sort of team status information. So we first tested this through interviews and heuristic evaluation. And it was one-on-one session. We would show the paper prototypes. And people felt it was still too much information. They were actually like striking through information and saying, no, I don't need this. I don't need this. I actually, like, it's just not necessary, right? I can just really ask my coworker or see where the steps are and how things are going. So we said, okay, so we're going to keep it a little bit longer because we still wanted to go into simulation with it just to see how teams are reacting in the context of work. But we pared down information, condensed this ABCD information, just, you know, highlighted the most important things. And then we also experimented with one addition, which was suggestion on moving more into like decision support system rather than just the status update. Like, if that neurological score, Glasgow Coma score, goes lower than 8, and you should consider probably patient intubation, right? So we just experimented with this a little bit. So we went into simulation, and this was activity-based design, team status information, and it turned out to be actually the worst one. They really didn't like this one. Even though, of course, patient information header, it's constantly rated high and really people really wanted always to see that kind of information, but everything else on the display, the linear representation of the work, the checked off items just simply didn't work. They were like saying, this is too complex just to have information checked out once and relying on it throughout the process. Right? So really showing this information linearly was confusing. It really didn't provide any data on the patient status and how the patients are doing. I mean, yes, the pulses have been checked, but is there actually patient having any pulses? Again, too static. So this was really a turning point where we said, okay, so we had to rethink the entire design. We've heard from quite a few people at this time, unique people, right? And we really need to think. And of course, they didn't really like being told what to do or even to consider what to do because they felt this was really just a display to show what the status is rather than tell them what to do. So we went back for that, another set of participatory design workshops. But this time we really focused on design functionality. We really wanted to hear again, right, what this display really needs to do, how it really needs to help these teams if there is a way. So we were like drawing a lot and trying to figure out how information changes or doesn't change. And we also used this to really validate all of the findings we were finding throughout the process. So, right, coming again back to that final design that I showed you right at the beginning, again, radical change, moving back into status, patient status information, forgetting about the team level, but not completely, right? So even though we show we are back into abnormal and normal findings, we are back into the patient status, we still show teamwork activity through the information that got produced by teamwork. Right, so if there is an ET tube inserted into the patient, that means somebody must have done intubation and somebody must have checked that airway and somebody must have assessed it, right? So it's sort of like still showing team status and what tasks have been completed, but through actually showing patient status and more into visual, that patient body emerged again as a really important way of showing information. Not just textual, although we kept both visual and textual because some people prefer textual list, some people want it visual. And then we also sort of experimented with this running ticker of orders, laboratory and radiology studies, because, you know, do you want requested or order or complete? So it was sort of like just an experiment. And response was much better on this display. Of course, there were still things that didn't work quite well. Like they really turned out, they really don't need that status on the, each of the tasks they do, A, B, C, D, E, because it's visible through other kinds of information. Textual information, right? It maybe felt a little bit still cluttered, but they really need the list of all the procedures and medications. But they felt the information is a lot more balanced than it was in previous designs. And we felt this was the design that that reached the point where we sort of finally got that understanding of how the information should be presented, and the people responded quite well to this. So it was really this state-based sort of design, patient status information that sort of won at the end. And then, of course, that brings me back again to the final design that we still did some iterations after that simulation, listening to some of the feedback that we got from people, showing also results from the secondary survey, not only primary, and then that hair changes depending on whether it's a boy or a girl, becomes pink if it's a girl. But anyway, so, right, so this is really version that is our next step. This will now be implemented in real resuscitations starting early next year. And when I say real resuscitations, like you don't have to like, oh, panic. No, it's actually gonna be very supervised process. We're gonna have a Confederate nurse entering information. If anything goes wrong with the display, it's just gonna shut down and forget about it, right? We are not interfering with patient care. This is not telling people what to do. It's really just providing status of what's happening in the room, what has been done. So what we realized through these simulations is that we really got great feedback on kinds of information to include, what to include, how to present it. But we really didn't really get a feel of, does it actually help people? Right? Does it actually really make their patient care more efficient? Does it really help their communication? So we really felt there is a need to move this further and push it further, really implement it into the real world scenarios. Like even though we had these high fidelity simulations, it still wasn't enough to really assess the effects of the display. So you're feeling that having it in the real world scenarios will tell us about, do they look at it? Do they use it? Does it really affect their communication? Does some of the communication redundancy or some of the redundancies in communication removed by having this kind of display up on the wall? And then just slowly wrapping up and trying to summarize, this is like a busy slide and it has quite a bit of information, but I just wanted to show you, right, as we were collecting those likes and dislikes throughout the different simulations, we were like seeing a nice trend, overall increase in likes and decrease in dislikes as we were moving from that activity-based into state-based design. Just for example, the header, which is the full line, third from the top, right? It was like stabilizing increasingly throughout the simulations with increasing percentage of likes and decreasing percentage of dislikes. So we just thought it was a really nice way, even though we cannot really put too much emphasis on this, but it was a really nice way of getting this overall feel of how people felt about different kinds of information features that were presented on the display. And then, of course, the most controversial feature was the ABCD that was really disliked at the very beginning. And it moved from 21% likes and 43% dislikes to like 17% dislikes and 20% likes, right? So it's sort of like, again, a little bit of that quant side, but not as much because it just was nice to see these trends. Right, so here is that, just again, as a summary, sort of you can really see how the design changed, evolved from version 1 through 6. It's an easy way of sort of comparing. So, right, we started off with lots of information, vital signs were included, but then we started to pare down the amount of information, and there was actually a point in version 4 when there was like too little information. There wasn't enough information to actually do anything with it. And this version point was also turning, version 4 was also a turning point where we realized that just linearly presenting the order of activities and the status of those activities is not really intuitive and helpful as much as actually showing the patient status, like abnormal, normal findings and what procedures have been done. So just quickly before I conclude, I wanted to come back quickly to those role-based differences I mentioned before. And what the data that we collected, all the likes and dislikes and little check marks and rankings, it was a really nice strategy to go around this tension that we saw between roles and different information needs. Because we gave everybody a voice, to a way to express their own voice without being hampered by powers in the room, and also just really free to speak up in a way and show what they thought of it. So what we wanted to really check, because we collected all this data, is that whether some roles compromised more than others, in a way that whether the features that they included in their individual designs, whether they propagated to the final designs and the group designs. And what we found is that we were able to include most of the information features that they included individually at the very beginning. And through this analysis, we sort of found that each role compromised on only 3 features or less. Which is like a lot of information, and you think about 3 features or less, well, there's nothing. But okay, most of the roles compromised in vital signs because we simply didn't include them, even though they all included them in their individual designs. And it's just interesting how they thought of this one display for everything rather than distributing it through different displays. And also, for example, anesthesia, respiratory, and scribes, they compromised in labs and radiology orders until we finally included them in the design. But this analysis really showed that no particular role appeared dissatisfied with the final design to the extent that they were like completely thrown away or just did not like it. Okay. So in summary, what this work really showed us is that the combination of fieldwork, because we've done a lot of that domain understanding and engaged really with the domain in different ways, but in combination with this participatory design where we really brought the teams in and really like took them as our partners and our collaborators and listened to them, really provided this opportunity to get in-depth domain knowledge, get these different kinds of feedback, right? And with each kinds of feedback, we got a different insight into what's going on, which really allowed for this holistic approach to system design. What's also nice is that participatory design, the way we did it here, it allowed us really to identify those information types that are really most important for teams, elicit and also manage these design tensions that we encountered, team versus role-based displays, or activity state, activity versus state-based displays, designs. And they really help us provide contextual examples of why certain designs work or not. And then finally, we realized that real-world implementation, not that it's needed, but it's really a way to really assess whether this kind of intervention helps or not. Because simulation, even though they were high fidelity, allowed us to and helped us to really understand what works in design or not and what people like or dislike. But you know, like your 3-year-old may want an ice cream, but what he or she really needs is veggies, right? So it's like, you know, it's really like seeing it in functioning in the real world context and how people respond to it, whether they look at it, whether they use it, whether they, we thought it through the real world implementation, we'll be able to find out about that. So this is about that. I just want to acknowledge our huge team and my PhD students and of course the necessary funding to do these kinds of work. But thanks so much for your attention. If there are any questions, I'll be happy to answer.
Thank you.
Yes, Jesse.
For the real world deployment, do you, like, what are the measures or what is the kinds of, what are you going to be collecting to evaluate that?
Okay.
One of the things that we've thought about is grounding in communication.
Mm-hmm.
As a way of, you can figure out if there's less, if there's less words that are used to ground some thing, maybe that means that you're getting it more efficiently.
Right. So what turns out throughout the discussions, right, that main purpose that emerged for the display is really to put everyone on the same page, which is really this awareness concept, right? And so we went back into literature and like, okay, let's find metrics for awareness. How do we measure awareness in this kind of environment? And communication really emerged as one of the really nice way of understanding to what extent really the display supports awareness of teams. So what we're doing is pre and post study, right? So we are collecting data right now, actually, they just work as normal without any AIDS displays up there. We're looking into their communication and specifically into redundant questions and questions that are related to information that's up on the display, right? Are they asking questions about a patient weight? It's up there throughout the entire event, but are we still hearing what's the weight, what's the weight, what's the weight? So those kinds of metrics. Then another one that we also found interesting is that initially in our field work, we saw that people rarely, like especially leaders, rarely consulted the flow sheet on the scribes table. And it's just interesting, like that flow sheet is the display because it has everything written on it. Everything that happened in that room is on that flow sheet. And yet leaders don't really go there and look at it, right? So let's compare, are they gonna be even looking less than they used to with the display, or maybe they'll actually start looking more just to cross-check, is the display showing the right? So I think that referral to other information sources is we will consider it as another metric just to see to what extent the display is being used. And then just some qualitative metrics of how often they look, when in the process they look. So those are the main ones, basically. But it was very hard. It was very challenging to find those metrics. It was like a really, how do you do it? Yes?
So I've got a question about the different roles.
Mm-hmm.
I'm trying to pull together two comments that you made. One was that you had these different roles who wanted different things on the screen,
mm-hmm.
and thus everyone had needed to compromise.
Mm-hmm.
And you made this other claim that with the vital signs, it was fine to just have basically distributed displays throughout the environment. So there's the vital sign displays, and then there's yours.
Mm-hmm.
So why can't we just, you know, in a sort of decog or ubiquitous computing approach, just distribute displays and
mm-hmm.
let's have different roles seeing different subsets of the information? Why do we need to put it all
into
one?
Yeah, and I think that's a great point, and that's another tension, that sort of design tension that we observe, like role-based versus team-based display, right? Can we actually have a display for each role individual on that in that room somewhere for their reference? And we really thought about it and discussed it extensively within our research team and with people, and there are a couple of, you know, there's, of course, both advantages and disadvantages. I think one of the major advantages is that you are escaping this entire drama of role-based differences and how do you reconcile it and how do you really make everyone happy, which is never possible, really, really possible. And then, but on the other hand, like, so just imagine there are about eight core roles on this team, right? So we have I don't need to list them, but eight different roles. Do we actually have space? How do we put those displays? Are they wearable? Are they on them? I think there's a really nice challenge for ubiquitous computing kind of exploring this, and it's really like only testing and design and trial error will tell those things. But we felt that we could start with the team-based display and see how far we get and how actually it works. because, you know, literature shows that in these kinds of environments, really the shared displays help with the grounding, common grounding, because everything's in one place, everybody's looking at it, everybody has the same image of what's going on in the room rather than different kinds of information.
A certain component of it is fixed, and it's team, So it's a different,
it can be sort of like a hybrid kind of combination with parts fading or turning into different kinds of. But it's a very nice tension to explore, right? Like cost is another issue, but you know, maybe with not today as much with the decreasing costs of displays. That's an excellent point. Yes, there was a question.
So I really like the design process that you used when mm-hmm. every part was participatory and mm-hmm. also tested with simulations. Right? Mm-hmm. I'm curious about, I think, I may have the understanding was wrong, but you do a simulation and then you vote on which features you used in the simulation, right? And with non-expert users, you've seen that those two factors, what you think you used and what you actually were looking at, mm-hmm. don't correlate all the time, mm-hmm. right? So for non-expert users, it might be great to say, oh, I really want a big logo here, right, mm-hmm. which says, okay, this is where I am, mm-hmm. but really you're not going to be looking at it, right? So you see this in Google search results pages all the time, right? People want the logo, but there are no fixations on the logo.
Yeah, right.
So I'm curious how you decided to, you know, evaluate those judgments that people made about this is useful and this is not useful.
Well, again, as I said, like those likes and dislikes that, you know, showed us trends overall of how feelings about the display were changing, right, throughout the time, and different versions of the display were more like just the indicators of how people felt about and really like giving us a targeted feedback. Right? I mean, if we really go carefully through the design, we did not necessarily always remove if something was full of excess, right? We sort of kept it because we knew that, you know, we heard them asking about that. Let's leave it there. Maybe they didn't like it in that particular design or layout, right? So I think it was really like it's sort of like it was a mechanism to really understand overall feelings about the display, but it was still, it was still used cautiously as a mechanism in the design decisions. If that answers your question, right? But the other thing is that the way we did it in the simulation, the likes, dislikes, not in in the, say, workshop or one-on-one, is because they were using it, they were right into it. They were in the work. They were with the fake patient, but they were using this display in the context of the work. So we figured if we use that mechanism right after that particular instance where they actually saw a display, they had the patient, they had this entire crazy situation of having to deal with the critically injured human being, right? Then maybe their perception of usefulness, like likeliness, will be a little bit more realistic than if it were just sitting in a room and discussing it. You know, so I think that was sort of another way of maybe trusting it a little bit more, right? But it's again a really good point. Was there a hand?
Did you do any of the simulations where you had a event that could trigger a critical state change to see did one display prompt the team to respond faster than another?
So the scenarios were sort of ranging from routine to very complex. And it's a really good question, what kind of scenarios we give them in these simulations? Because if you give them super easy routine, like you're not getting any data basically, because you know everything goes smooth, everything's fine. On the other hand, if you give them like super complex scenario where they're like totally lost and they have no idea what's going on, like forget it, right? The display, it doesn't really get that attention that would otherwise get if they, you know, if they really fixate on the patient. And that's again something that we want to see in the real scenario. When these critical patients really come in, are they just forget about a display as much as they forget about anything that's happening, right? We talked about it yesterday. In routine cases, everything functions smoothly, everything's fine, but as long as they get the gunshot wound, they just go nuts. So again, that's why we were seeing that, you know, simulations are great, but really, like, to really assess the effectiveness of something, we really need that real drama happening in there. So, yeah, we'll see. Was there a question?
Yeah, it's really great work. I appreciate the way you're talking about it and how you thought about it. Dovetailing on what he just said, have you, you might have done this. Like, if you mapped out all the processes and all the roles within those groups, because it seems like, you have the different scenarios going on.
Right.
So have you looked at that, and what are you doing?
Like, so map the entire...
the whole experience, like all the process. You know, you have all the roles in the process.
Right.
So you could just have one part of that.
So which role, like which feature,
which didn't you mean? I'm not.
It's like an overall user experience that you have, like from beginning to end, and then it varies according to the different things that happen.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. Yeah. I mean,
you have extensive spreadsheets. You have the.
Right. Yeah. This is a lot of back and forth and trial and error, trying to really go into data from different angles and trying to understand what was happening, and I think. It's just even, there's so much data that, we didn't even get to, analyze everything. But you know, and this is, of course, not finished story. But I'm just saying that we feel like, this is good for now, and let's see how it fares in the real-world scenarios. But we believe that the designs will change, continue to evolve and change. And then another interesting thing what we are doing is that because we believe that, right, and that's why simulations didn't quite work for assessing the effectiveness, is because they only have 10, 15 minutes to use it. And we train them a little bit in front of, before simulation, and say, okay, here is what the features you're going to see, and here's how they appear. But that's it, right? And then they do the simulation and go away. And that's the last time they see the display. So that's why we need a longer term engagement to just get people habituated and used to it, so that they actually know that there is a display out there that they can refer to in need. So before we are, right now as we are doing pre-study, we actually have these posters with these final version 6 in the common lounges where the residents and fellows gather for lunch and whatever, socializing, where nurses and technicians. So we just have these posters, sort of like passive-aggressive feedback gathering, and just getting them to just get used to it, seeing it around. So once we put it into the trauma, they're like, oh yeah, I know, I've seen it already, I know what it is. And then it's also a way to actually get the feedback on just tell us what you think, like cross whatever you don't like, or tell us. So it's again, we thought it's a nice way of just habituate a little bit and get used to them used to it. And then once we put it in the real world, then we can see if that's going to help. But yeah.
Sorry, I lost this. So throughout your process, it seems like a very equal process where you have
democratic
equal participation,
yeah,
from nurses all the way through surgeons.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm trying to balance that with the fact that the design will continue to change, as you say, when
mm-hmm.
you put it into the trauma room.
Mm-hmm.
And I would guess that in such a situation, those with more power in the trauma room will sort of affect the decisions made, right? So how do you plan to go around?
Well, I mean, depends, right? I mean, we still want to keep everybody involved. We are really fortunate to have the chief of trauma that is also very, already understands the power of technology and what it does, right? And even though he's on the team, he's been pretty remote and wasn't really participating in any of the discussions because we didn't want any of the influence of, oh, we are having a chief of trauma in the room. Everybody listens to what he says, right? But I think that in general, we'll try the best to just keep them involved.
I guess the more practical version of that question is, if you had to optimize version 6 for the surgeon instead of for everybody in the room, how would it look different?
Oh, I see what you're saying. If it was just for a surgeon.
Yeah, I mean, if the person you're optimizing for was the surgeon,
right,
in this case.
Right. Well, for example, what would change is that probably that image would disappear. Because what was interesting is that in some of the discussions, they were saying, well, I walk into the room, I see that tube on a face, I know the patient's intubated, I see the IV, I know there's an IV on the left arm, right? So I don't really need a graphical depiction of that. But you know, but again, it's a very right. I mean, it depends on the context. Like even though there's a lot of information externalized on this graph, there is still some information that's not obvious, right? I mean, when was what's the gauge number for IV or what's the really like the what's the tube size and things like that, right? So there's certain information that's still hidden and needs to be sort of asked or but yeah, I don't know, we'll see. It will be interesting to move into that individual displays and see how they would change. I think it would be a nice exercise. Oh yes.
Oh, we have two heads.
So I was wondering about that part where you were saying that you added a part that was suggesting another procedure that they could take, and then people didn't really feel good about it.
Right.
I was wondering how much do you think that that was a way of the people who are already doing this procedure for years, and they're kind of maybe kind of fixated on how they're doing it and how they're deciding on it, or how much do they think that this might distract what they're actually, like, what they're used to doing?
Yeah.
Or how much is it that they view this as a screen that's supposed to give information, and maybe if it was a different screen that was supposed to give suggestions, then that would help. I was wondering if you...
Right, well, so first of all, I think I was really sort of just, okay, let's just try this experiment, and honestly, like, two simulations aren't really enough to answer that fully, right? I mean, and really understand. We just got this very initial, even the hunch-based feeling of, no, we don't need that. We know that once we go below 8 on the Glasgow Coma Score, we need to intubate. Like, we've done it. We are experts. We don't really need you telling us to do it. But I think, again, we took it with a grain of salt, because in those chaotic situations, when we see patients fixated, clinicians fixated on that blood coming out of wound and completely ignoring Glasgow Coma Score or forgetting to even assess it, and then in those situations, you know, this kind of a suggestion would probably say, "Hey, pay attention. Your score is really going low, right? Something's going on with the patient because everybody's fixating on that blood coming out of a wound, but nobody's really thinking about the necessary things, right?" So those kinds of situations, right? But again, yeah, the simulations were too short and too few to really explore this into depth. But we still just, you know, did a little more like anecdotal experiment on just seeing the what would be the hunch for that. And there was a hand.
I was wondering that, have you ever tried using any dynamic layout to display this image information?
So the information changes, right? So for example,
yeah.
This is a running list of treatments,
yeah,
as they are being administered. It just runs up and down, scrolls basically. The images, the icons change as the status changes, right? So for example, once the physician surveyor who's evaluating the patient says breathing equal bilateral or diminished on the right side, right, we will show the lungs color-coded for that kind of finding, right? So the information appears, disappears from the screen depending on what the findings, what the information's being reported or captured. But then, so that's basically the dynamic part of it for now. The other thing that, again, and that some of the career work that I proposed is to really explore the extent to which we can make it interactive. So can we actually have, maybe with some technology like Kinect, actually moving through the display, and because there's so much happening in the room, right? So can we actually have people interacting with it on a timeline basis, right? Or something like that, like different ways of presenting this information. That's why I'm saying this is really just feels like the beginning.
I'm not an expert in medicine, but
yeah.
Is there a possibility that different kinds of information has different importance during the process of the treatment.
So
since people are complaining about you're showing too much information to them, you can just display this different parts during the different stages.
Exactly, like some information interest and some information fades throughout the process. But for example, like never remove the age and weight, right? Because that's something that's needed throughout the process. But maybe we can remove once they know what labs were ordered, maybe we can remove them or something like that. Absolutely, I think those are great suggestions, and we thought about making it even more dynamic and again interactive and exploring some of that.
Great, let's thank our speaker.
Thanks. Thank you so much.